I'm here at Elmira prison camp, Civil War prison camp, and a story that usually you don't hear is a story of Confederate prisoners that were brought north. A lot of people hear about the Andersonville prison where Union prisoners were kept throughout the war, but a lot of people don't know about this site. Now I'm here with Doug Oakes. He's a local historian, and he works with an organization that's trying to preserve the Elmira Civil War prison camp. So Doug, thank you for coming. Can you give me a little information on the camp itself and how long was it in operation for?
The camp was opened up originally in 1861. It was enlarged in 62 for all Union troops up to that time, New York State Volunteers. It wasn't until 1864 with the overflow of POWs that they opened this up as a prisoner of war camp. When they did, they put up a 12-foot stockade fence all the way around it, and packed her pretty well full at first. Then when they ran out of buildings, they used tents. And then by the end of December of 64, all the POWs were actually inside barrack buildings, and the barrack buildings had wood stoves and coal stoves in them, so they weren't heated to them.
And the size of the camp was how many acres?
Between 30 and 40 acres. We figured closer to 40.
Okay, and it held how many prisoners at any one time?
At any one time, it ran between 9,500 to 10,000.
Okay, so what we're going to do, Doug is going to take us through some of the buildings that are here, and we'll get an idea of what the camp was like. From 1861 to about 1864, this was actually a camp for Union soldiers. At first it was for volunteers, and then in 1863, when the draft was created, it became a draft depot. But in 1864, it was turned into a prison camp for Confederates. So, Doug, can you tell me about the wall and what happened when it was a prison camp?
The first thing they had to do in 64, May of 64, they built a stockade. It was 12 foot high and enclosed about 40 acres. What you're looking here from this side, that would be the outside. That would be the inside.
Mm-hmm. And how tall of a...
It was 12 foot, the stockade itself was 12 foot high.
Right.
It had a walkway all the way around, and every so many yards or feet, they had a stairwell to come up, and they had these guard posts posted all the way around.
And then you said a story of an entrepreneur,
yep,
that wanted to sell tickets to watch the Confederates. So maybe tell us a little bit about that.
What he did, he built himself outside of the wall a tower. And this one isn't the whole thing, because it would actually be higher with a second story on it. But what he did, he charged people 10 cents to come up and they could look inside and see the POWs. Then he sold refreshments down underneath for that. Now, for 15 cents, you could get up on top on the second story. And if you wanted to, he had it so you could rent binoculars so you could see the Confederates. That, the original tower stood until the end of the war. I think the second one they built, because there was a second one built, they tore down. Mm-hmm. The story was the reason the first one stood was because he was a Republican and the other guy was a Democrat. That's the story.
Entertainment in the 19th century.
The government finally closed both towers down, but they kept the one standing for their own use to see inside and whatever else.
And it was just built out of wood.
Yes, yeah,
nothing,
no big expenses.
No permanent.
This whole camp in 66, basically, mm-hmm, they put everything up for auction.
So all the barracks were sold?
Everything was sold. A lot of it was disassembled, and some of the houses and other buildings in Elmira were built from the camp lumber.
Okay, so let's take a look at the barracks then. Thank you. I'm standing in front of a reconstructed barracks. Now, in 1861, this barracks would have been built for Union troops that were volunteering. And then when the draft came, they had to build more of them. So we're going to walk into one of these. And, you know, this would have been a typical barracks for, a Union company. So Doug is going to explain a little bit what life was like while it was a Union barracks.
Well, like you were saying, this was built for Union troops in 61. It was made to hold one full company or 100 men. As you can see how the bunks are set up, we've got a couple of the bed ticks in. There was two men per section, up and down. Mm-hmm. One slept one way, one the other, so you got to smell each other's feet.
Oh, great. Yeah, sounds wonderful.
But that would run all the way down. The only ventilation in the first ones that were built were these windows. No glass, just cut holes for the windows you can close up.
And if you notice, no indoor plumbing, no bathroom facilities. Imagine in the summer, no electricity. So this would be life, your introduction into life into the Union Army. Now, I mentioned something about the summer, and Doug was talking about the ventilation. But imagine in the winter. This is upstate New York. It's going to be very cold. So, Doug, can you tell us about the heating?
What they did, they put two stoves in each barrack building. So when they tell you the Confederates never had heat, that is not true. By December they did. A little late in the winter, but they had them in by then. The first stoves burnt wood, and then later they converted them over to coal, because we're not that far from the Pennsylvania coal mines that are built in Pennsylvania, so it was easy.
So it was a cheap source of heat.
Yeah, that it was. But that's how they heated up. There's two of them in here. Each one is about a third of the way in. Mm.
And there would have been a flue.
Yes, out of here, it would go up. Actually, from all we can tell, it would bend and then go out.
Okay.
And in 1862, late 62, they actually built cupolas. One here and one out the other end for ventilation.
Right. Okay. That's good. Another aspect of Army life would have been discipline. Imagine all of a sudden 17, 18-year-old guys coming in to a camp away from their parents for the first time. So, Doug, can you tell us a little bit about discipline in the Union Army?
It basically was for both sides run this way. This is a simple thing. If the guy was caught drunk and a pain in the neck, he'd have to wear this thing either walking around camp or sometimes they'd stand him on a barrel. And that it all depended how long they wanted to keep them there. Another one used both in places like this and in the field was hanging a man by his thumbs. They would tie both thumbs, wrap it around a tree limb or something like these, and just his toes would be touching the ground. And he was suspended by his thumbs until they got done with that. Another one was buck and gag, and I can't get down anymore. But a guy would be placed on the ground with his knees up, a stick put behind his knees, and his hands would be tied to that, and he's all hunched over, and then he had a buck, what they call, or a gag, was another wooden stick jammed into his mouth and tied behind his head. And then there's one outside, I'll show you in a little while, they used to call the horse. It looks like a sawhorse.
Right.
And you had to sit that thing straddle. I have done it, and very uncomfortable.
Now, is that for minor infractions?
For anything up, it was a major infraction. Sometimes you'd wind up, there's a box down here that we use as the sweat box, and you could take a person and nail him into that thing or shove him into it. There'd be a little slit, which we haven't got on that one for whatever, and that sits out in the sun.
Wow.
And there you are, all day. And...
So I want you guys to remember that next time you don't do your homework, okay?
This box here is a rough reproduction of what may have been used for a sweat box. And there would have been a slit up here, all about yay wide, through there so you could see inside and the guy could get a little air. But the whole principle was to stick him in there, seal it, and then this would sit out in the sun. And yes, it can get hot here in Elmira.
And you'd be standing up.
You'd be standing up, just like that.
Amazing.
And you would stand the whole time.
That I cannot imagine. Being sealed in, No thanks.
It was probably a little wider than this, or not wider, but the sides came out a little more. But this was also about the size for the caskets they built.
Yeah. And they and the Confederates that did die here, they did get caskets. Yeah.
When they were placed in these and sealed up, each one of them, we were talking about it earlier, they took a small jar, glass jar. And in that jar, on a piece of paper, was the guy's name, his rank, and his unit. And that was stuck under his armpit.
Okay.
When they put him in. So if they ever had to dig him back up and identify him, they had that information.
So let's discuss the Elmira camp as now a prison camp. So by 1864, it became a prison camp for Confederates. And this area of the barracks they have set up really for to tell the Confederate story. So Doug, can you tell us a little bit about the Confederate story here?
Well, the Confederates came in, I think it was June 6th. It was the first batch of 64. There was 400 of them. When they first got here, Uncle Sam, in his great wisdom, had forgot to put guards here, so they had to go all through the city and round up whatever troops there was to make them guards here temporarily until they got guard mounts. There was other barrack buildings, newer ones, differently built than these. They started building them in 62 and into 63, so there was more barrack buildings by the time the POWs came in.
All right.
We had three escapes just out of the first 400. One escaped in New York City before he even got on the train. One escaped right here at the front entrance while they were processing. He just walked away and nobody paid attention to him. And within the first 48 hours, two had climbed the stockade wall and gone over and out. Let's see. They quickly packed this place up, and then after the buildings were full, they put up A tents. Now, an A tent will hold anywhere from 4 to 6 men. It's a regular standard Army issue tent, so they weren't just getting little scraps and stuff.
Right.
The tents, when they were first set up, we can't prove it, but I have read somewhere that there was actually a tent stove, a small one set up. They had straw and possibly like a wooden pallet in there at first until the first grand escape through a tunnel, and they found out what they were doing was digging underneath the tents, and they dug out.
Wow.
And once they did that, out came the straw, out came the pallets, and right. You were on the bare ground.
Sure. That's interesting. Yeah. All right. So that was very interesting about the barracks, but you have other things on the grounds as well. I see you have a platform here, and you got some kind of weird horse thing going over there.
That was the other...
Get rid of that.
That was the other form of discipline. You take a man, and he'd have to sit on this straddle.
On the square beam.
Yes, yeah. And it rips up between your legs something fierce. And it all depended on what you did as to how long you'd be here. And then, if you were really a pain, they'd actually hang weights from your ankles.
Oh.
Discipline back then, you wouldn't get away from it.
Right,
at all.
Now you're going to get punished, that's for sure. So, this is made the same kind of specifications.
On the same
one.
Spec.
Okay.
Roughly.
And then you have this here.
This we use to give you an idea of what the tower was like that the civilians built.
It would have been at least 2 stories.
Oh, right? Yeah, and a lot taller than this. They were both, I believe, close to 40 feet tall.
Wow.
They were huge.
Wow.
The one that we're going to build over there is going to be 20 feet. And from that, we hope you can see over the Fort Dupont.
So this is the island here?
That's the island. I'll take you out on there later.
Okay.
And the pond... doesn't run that far now, but see that clump of trees by itself out there?
Yeah.
It ran at least that far.
Okay.
The pond did.
Okay. So this is in the middle of the camp right here?
This?
Or the back end?
The whole back of the camp.
So like everything else over the years, topography changes, the geography changes, but to get an idea of this side of the camp, right over there, that white pillar right there, that would have been where the wall was, right? The wall.
Yep, that would have been the east wall.
And then what you see over here is a dike, a flood dike that was put in 1946. So that wouldn't have been there. But if you come this way, and you can see the Chemung River there, and then Doug will tell you about the camp and how it outstretched this way.
What you ran into when the smallpox came in, they had to keep them separate from the rest of the population. So they put them on the other side of Foster's Pond, which was a lot bigger than what it is today. And they were out there on the island. There was a smallpox hospital out there, and then they had a whole bunch of tents that they would keep them in.
Mm-hmm.
That helped keep it confined. You can see it runs quite a ways down through. The stockade actually ran, it would have been out today, it would be in the river.
Right.
But it ran out there. And at one time, there was actually a small back gate. I know that was there for the Union troops so they could go out and bathe and do their laundry and stuff.
So they did permit the Confederates to bathe in the river?
I can't prove that.
Okay.
I can't. I don't know for sure. But as I told you earlier, there were wells around here. There was, I think there was five or seven of them right along Water Street.
Mm-hmm.
And down on the far end of here, there was five hospitals they built within the camp. And between each hospital was another well.
So that's another interesting story. There is a story that this was called Hellmyra, that this was worse than Andersonville prison down in Georgia, but that is not true. So Doug, can you tell us why that is not true?
Well, first off, if you look at any of the photographs of Andersonville and or read the descriptions, there were no buildings at all in that camp. They just packed them in there and that was it. They had a piece of cloth or old blanket or something. They'd build a little shed over themselves and dig a hole in the ground. That's all they had. The first batch of inmates coming into here, or POWs, went into all the existing barracks that were in here being used by the Union troops. When it got overcrowded and they had too many, they started putting them in tents, A tents. A tents will hold 4 to 6 people. They're a standard issue military tent. Matter of fact, the A tents were probably better than most of the Confederates were used to.
Right.
So they packed them all in, but they had regular standard rations to start with. And by December, every POW was inside a barrack building, and each barrack building was heated with 2 stoves. So you got to make a big difference there. So Andersonville had nothing. There were kitchens and mess halls set up in here. Because there were so many of them, they couldn't seat them in the mess hall, so they would just march them through. And because there were so many, they only had a meal in mid-morning and mid-afternoon toward the evening, instead of 3. The rations here were cut in half because of what they heard about in Andersonville. By, I think it was February of 65, they rose it back up to 3/4 rations. It never went back to full.
So in the end, the stories of this place being the worst prison camp, that's not true. So the Union did treat the Confederates with respect as much as they could. And next we'll talk about what happened to the dead. So we're trying to find the end of the camp, or the edge of the camp. And today, again, the river has changed. It's got to become wider. So, Doug, can you tell us where the edge of the camp would have been, the back of the camp?
The river itself, that bank is pretty well close to where the original was, and you come 25 feet this way. So, I mean, you're talking, another 50 feet
sure.
out into where the middle was, and that would have been where the stockade wall was. This island would have gone all the way out. Today it's been knocked down one for the because of the flooding
mm-hmm.
and the river current itself. And when they put a dam in down here to back this up for the water pumps,
this whole thing spread out.
So many great stories are connected to the prison here in Elmira, and one of them is about an escaped slave named John Jones. So, Doug, can you tell us about John?
John Jones came up here in 1840s. He escaped from a plantation in Virginia. He later became the sexton for one of the churches and used to do a lot of the public burials. And when the war broke out and the camp started, he got the contract to bury the Confederate dead. This is the house he lived in, but this is not the location of the house. They moved it. It used to be at the end of this block is where it sat. So it's quite close to where it is. There's an organization, the John Jones organization, that owns the place and runs it. They're running it as a museum, and they do give tours inside, but I don't think anybody's here today. So we'll go from there. It is said that he actually moved more slaves through on the Underground Railroad than anybody else did, even her name.
Incredible. Harriet, yeah.
Harriet, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I'm standing in Woodlawn National Cemetery in Elmira, New York. And this is a unique spot. This is a spot where both Union and Confederate soldiers are actually buried in the same mass grave. So can you tell us about that, Doug?
One of the trains coming up from New York City with a load of POWs, somebody made the mistake of sending two trains at the same time from opposite directions. And down at Chihuahua, Pennsylvania, on a real blind turn, they hit head on. You see here a list of all the Confederate prisoners of war that were killed in that wreck. And on the other side is a list of all the Union guards that were on the train that also died.
So right under our feet are a mixed grave of Confederates and Union soldiers.
Yep. Probably the only grave site you'll find where both Union and Confederate are buried together.
Amazing story. This section of the cemetery is reserved for Confederate soldiers that died at the camp. So, Doug, can you tell us a little bit about this area?
They set this section aside
for the POWs. There are roughly 2,975 in here, give or take. Each one of the Confederates that were buried in here were identified, and each one has a headstone. The original headstones were made of wood, but later on, when the National Cemetery people took it over, they were all converted over, probably the very early 1900s, maybe late 1800s. So each one is marked. There's a couple of unknown in here. There's actually a few of them that are marked Richmond Civilian or Citizen of Richmond. There's one and some others like that. That one that's marked Citizen of Richmond was captured in Richmond Works by the Union Cavalry raid and was taken prisoner and brought up here. So he actually was a civilian with one of the local militias that went out to defend the works in front of Richmond and scarfed up.
We're standing in Western New York in a field of 3,000 Confederate soldiers. What you have here is something that you don't really see that much. You have a Union soldier, survived, died after the war, laying right next to the remains of a Confederate soldier that died at the prison. You can see that there are different types of headstones. The national government decided that the Union soldiers would have rounded headstones and the Confederates would have angled. So here we have basically the end of the war where everybody's together. So as you walk through these cemeteries, you get an idea of the human aspect of the war. This unfortunate soldier is probably brought north. They know he's a Union soldier, might have been sick. Nobody really identified him. He probably passed away at a hospital and then was interned here. And then as you keep going, you'll see some of the other stories, like U.S. colored troops. So some of the soldiers here are African-American. When you're in a place like this, you really start to think of their lives. You think of the country, and you really should come to these places to pay your respects. So this would be the entry point for prisoners coming from the South or other parts of the country. You'd let out here, they'd be marched down this street and all the way to the prison camp, which is a few miles away.